Welcome to the Genealogy Gems podcast. It's a show filled with family history research strategies and techniques, news and entertainment, and inspiration. And I'm your host, Lisa Louise Cook. Hello and welcome to Genealogy Gems podcast episode number 144. And I'm so glad that you are joining me today because I've got a lot of gems for you. And one of them focuses on a challenge that we all face as family historians, getting organized, archiving all of our stuff, digitizing materials and photographs. I know that's biting off a big chunk, but it's such an important one. And in this episode, I'm going to start to break it down for you with the help of the family curator, Denise Levenick. She's written a book. It's called How to Archive Family Keepsakes. And she's got a lot of practical advice to share, and that's coming up in just a bit. This is a very timely topic for me because even though it's fall, I've been kind of in spring cleaning mode. You see, I do a lot of traveling, of course, in the springtime. That's when all the conferences are going on. And it certainly picks up again in the early fall. But once I finish up my travel during Family History Month in October, November and the rest of the fall sort of become my chance to catch up and reorganize. Well, this time around, I've been focusing on getting through all the items that we brought home from Bill's mom's house after she moved last month, and the even bigger project of tackling my craft room. Those of you out there who have a craft room, you know what I'm talking about. I don't know where all that stuff comes from, but it has, again, become a bit unwieldy. So I've been tossing and reorganizing, and I even made a spot for the pack and play crib that we have for when grandbabies come over to visit. Finally, I can keep it up all the time. Over there in the corner, I have a space against the wall without having to fold it all up every time after they visit. Now, if you've ever tried to manhandle one of those portable cribs, then you know how hard that can be. So this was a big success. Another motivation for working on my craft room was to assess what I have to work with for some of the family history projects that I have in mind for Christmas time. Now, I've got some picture framing to do. Oh, and I found an old tin tray. I had tucked it away years ago thinking, oh, well, maybe I'll paint this or doing something with it. But I think it would be perfect for kind of a family history photo decoupaging project. And, of course, I need to get stocking put together for our new grandson, Joey. So I have a long list of projects that I want to do, and I need a place to do it. So it feels good to get organized and to know that you're ready for whatever opportunities present themselves, right? And there have been several things popping up in the genealogy news that might just help you out with what you're working on in your family history. First of all, FamilySearch recently announced that their U.S. Immigration and Naturalization Community Project is halfway to its 2012 goal of 30 million records. Now, in August of 2012, FamilySearch announced its next major U.S. community project was going to be the U.S. Immigration and Naturalization Records. The project will create an extensive free online collection of U.S. passenger lists, boarding crossing records, naturalization records, and more, invaluable to genealogy researchers. The online volunteer community is 2 months into the project and aiming to index 30 million records by the end of the year. They've got over 85,000 volunteers, more than 15 million records that they've been working on have already been completed. So you can see what's going on at the U.S. Immigration and Naturalization projects that are currently underway, or you can check on their status at familysearch.org/immigration. You can join the community also of online indexers and arbitrators that are helping to make passenger lists and naturalization records freely searchable on familysearch.org. So to get started with that, again, familysearch.org/immigration. Also, they have some current and completed projects. You can view a list of currently available indexing projects, along with their record language and completion percentage. Visit the FamilySearch indexing updates page to learn more about individual projects, and I'll have that link for you in the show notes. Of particular note are their already completed projects. Now, these recently completed projects that they've done have been removed from the available online indexing batches, and they're now going to go through a final completion check process, but they will be published very soon at FamilySearch.org. So you'll want to be sure to check back in on a regular basis to see what's new over there. Included in the list are records from Argentina, Brazil, Italy, and the UK. And here in the U.S., they have general index to pension files from 1861 to 1934, the first part of that project. They've just completed the index to Indian Wars pension files from 1892 to 1926. Indiana, Park County marriages, 1811 to 1959. In Kentucky, they've got Trimble, Hickman, and Russell counties wills, Part B, that's done. And in New York, the 1855 state census. In Oklahoma, they've got land allotment records of the five civilized tribes. They run from 1899 to 1907. This was Part D of that project. For Tennessee, they've got county marriages 1790 to 1950. That's been an ongoing project. And county marriages in Texas, this is the first part of several parts of this project, 1837 to 1977. And they've been working on World War I draft registration cards. These range from 1917 to 1918. Again, going on the FamilySearch.org website for free, they have completed Indiana, Kansas, Minnesota, New Jersey, South Carolina, Ohio, Rhode Island, Vermont, Virginia, and West Virginia. So that's pretty exciting to have those coming online. And over at ancestry.ca, the Canadian Ancestry website, they have also made some announcements recently. They've launched some new Canadian military record collections. Now, for a short time here in November of 2012, from the 8th to the 12th, they have free access available to select military records from some of the most popular collections. I've blogged about this on the Genealogy Gems website. And those records include covering soldiers of the First World War, the Rebellion of 1837, and the War of 1812. Also, in honor of Remembrance Day, which was November 1st of 2012, Ancestry.ca, they announced the launch of more than 1.5 million new historical Canadian military records that span more than 100 years. And according to their press release, the new records cover the First and Second World Wars, highlight the everyday lives of soldiers who serve their country. The records, which include military awards, service records, and information on pay, will provide Canadians with a greater understanding of the men and women who fought in the conflicts that helped define this nation. Two brand new Canadian collections, the Canada Military Honors and Awards Citation Cards from 1900 to 1961, and the Canada Nominal Rolls and Pay Lists for the Volunteer Militia, 1857 to 1922, along with 30,000 new records in the existing Canada War Graves Registers, Circumstances of Casualty, 1914 to 1948 collection, will be of great interest to any Canadians with military ancestors. Ancestry.ca has also added the UK Commonwealth War Graves. They range from 1914 to 1921 and 1939 to 1947. It's a big collection. It includes graves and memorials for Canadian soldiers who fought in the First and the Second World Wars. And over at Google, they recently announced that Google Maps just got the biggest Street View update ever. That is good news. They've doubled the number of special collections and updated over 250,000 miles of roads around the world in Google Maps. Now, I know that many of you have been concerned because, much of your research is around the world. It's not just in the U.S. or in Canada. And you've wondered about whether Street View, which really gets you up close and personal to specific street locations, you've wondered if it's really available outside the U.S. Well, Google has increased Street View coverage in Macau, Singapore, Sweden, the U.S., Thailand, Taiwan, Italy, Great Britain, Denmark, Norway, and Canada. And they are launching special collections in South Africa, Japan, Spain, France, Brazil, and Mexico, among several others. So the answer is feel free to roam the globe for ancestor locations because Street View is making its way around the world. They've also recently updated the Google Earth satellite imagery database. This refresh to the imagery has now been updated for 17 cities and 112 countries and regions. So Google Maps and Google Earth have never been better for genealogy research. And of course, if you want to learn more about what Google Earth can do for you as a genealogist, be sure and check out my free YouTube videos. They'll show you what you can learn in my video CD series. It's called Google Earth for Genealogy. Some pretty cool stuff you can do, and more than just looking up the address of your own house, right? You can find the CD series at genealogygems.com at the store. And we have the videos that are kind of 2 and 3 minute short videos over at YouTube at youtube.com/genealogygems. So you can take a look and kind of get a good overview of what's possible. And speaking of my website, I want to let all of you premium members know that I've put together a quick little video that will walk you through the process of setting up your premium podcast feed in iTunes. I have received a couple of questions on this lately, so I thought it just might help if you could see it done in action. So you'll find a link on the premium episodes page. All you have to do is sign in first up in the menu to premium and to premium episodes, and that link will take you over to the video and the instructions for setting up your premium iTunes feed. It's a one-time process that you follow, but we've got it for you so that you can watch it on the screen and follow along. And as I announced in the most recent Genealogy Gems newsletter, which comes out about twice a month, I hope you're on the list, I have added a video recording of one of my my most popular classes to the premium video collection. The class is called How the Genealogist Can Remember Everything with Evernote. In fact, the other day I got an email from Kelly, who is a premium member. She writes, "Thank you so much for your podcast on Evernote. I've been on YouTube watching videos about it, but they were hard to follow and more advanced or too techie. Your podcast was easy to follow and went over the basics, and I really appreciate that. I think I am finally ready to try it." That is such good news, Kelly. That's exactly what we're shooting for. I really want everyone to know what Evernote can do for you. It's a free tool. It's an online website and a tool that you download to your computer. They've got apps for the smartphone and the iPad, and it's super cool. It just does some really great stuff. And the class will spell it all out for you. So if you would like to be able to watch the Evernote class from the comfort of your own home, as Kelly did, please do join us as a Genealogy Gems premium member. You can do that at our website, genealogygems.com. Okay, well, now I'm ready to hear from you, and we're going to do that over at the mailbox.
From my old hometown, one with some jokes from my old pal Jim Brown. Bring me a letter from that girl of mine, saying that he's longing for me all the time. Bring me a letter from my proud old dad, knows that we are winning, and I bet he's glad. But more than any other, a line from my old mother. Bring me a letter from my hometown.
Okay, here at the mailbox, first up, I've got an email from Patience. This was kind of a fun one to get. Let me just read it to you here. It says, "I have recently become very interested," okay, obsessed, she says in capital letters, "with genealogy. I started your podcast about 3 weeks ago, and I've already listened and re-listened to the Family History Podcast, and I'm about halfway through the Genealogy Gems podcast." Let me tell you, folks, that's a lot of listening in just 3 weeks. Patience says, "Because of your help and advice, I've become religious about citing references and with triple checking my facts, which I am thankful for since I just started a few months ago and I want to do this the right way. So thank you very much. But anyways, the reason I am writing, I've noticed in your podcast, other podcasts, blogs, and at workshops that I've attended, that there's a concern about the next generation. I do understand, but I wanted to share with you my experience in hopes of easing everyone's worries. I'm 23 years old, and let me tell you, I stick out like a sore thumb at workshops, as I usually am the youngest by at least about 30 years. That being said, when I started researching, I met one of my cousins on Ancestry.com, and we really hit it off. We have all the same interests. We're kind of like long-lost twins. For a while, I assumed that she was retired and much, much older than I, but after several emails, I found out she's only 2 years older than me. I, too, worry about my generation, but I think after some maturing, most will at least have an appreciation for the past and everything that it has to offer, or at least I hope. But all I know is that there are two very pretty 20-something girls thousands of miles apart that would rather research and learn than go to parties. So that seems pretty hopeful, I think. Thanks for all you do. Keep it up. Patience. Patience, I love that email. Yes, it is reassuring. Isn't it reassuring, everybody? Everybody listening out there? You know, I remember going to my first genealogy society meeting. I think I was probably in my late 30s, and I walked in, you know, with long blonde hair, and I just saw a lot of, you know, gray-haired retired people. And I was like, they just welcomed me in. And as soon as you realize you're all on the same journey and you're all kind of looking for the same stuff, who cares, right? But it is good to know, certainly, that younger folks are thinking about these things and they're out there, you know. And what's interesting is I think when we go to conferences, we don't always see young people, but a conference is not always the first thing on a young person's list, and also just making the time for it. You know, they don't always have a weekend or a full week to take off, and certainly the cost involved might be prohibitive. But one thing I've learned about this from doing this podcast is that I do hear from those of you who are younger, and that is really cool because it means the podcast can kind of reach you where you are, even if you don't have the time or resources to get out to a conference right away. So it's all very encouraging, and thank you, Patience, for helping us all realize that you guys are out there. So thank you so much for listening. All right, my next email here is from Jennifer, who takes her iPad on the road for genealogy, and she has a couple of items here. She says, on Friday, I was doing a marathon cooking session, and I caught up on a couple of podcasts while I was at it. I'm not sure which one it was in that you mentioned a vampire kit and wondered whether it was a real thing. You may have heard this from many sources by now, but indeed it is a real thing. The TV show called Auction Kings had one as an item that they told the history of in the course of putting it up for auction at their warehouse in Atlanta. This is on the Discovery Channel. In fact, you can stream this show via Netflix, and the blurb for it even mentions a vampire kit in the description. Lastly, kudos for turning me on to a nifty iPad shortcut. Your latest book has some tips in the back, which is where, of course, I skipped to after dutifully reading the first three chapters or so. The tips about swiping the comma / exclamation point to create an apostrophe and the other shortcut for quotation marks are so great. I will no doubt find many other useful items when I return to reading. Honestly, your books are so full of wonderful information, I have to take a break before my head explodes. Not pretty. Oh, we don't want any head exploding. Okay. That's great. Awesome. I'm so glad that worked out for you, Jennifer, and that you're enjoying the book. And in fact, got a really nice post on Facebook the other day from Pat Oxley. Now, she's a genealogist. I've been friends with her on Facebook for a while. I've never met Pat in person, but you know how we all get together on Facebook. She wrote the other day, she posted, despite another day of coughing and basically feeling yuck. I guess she was sick and kind of under the weather. She says, I bought and downloaded Lisa Louise Cook's new book, Turn Your iPad into a Genealogy Powerhouse. It is fabulous. And it's so nice she put it in big capital letters. She says, I worked my way through the book, taking notes, and then downloaded and played with some of the apps she suggested. Thank you, Lisa Louise. And I will say, it's a terrific book, even if you're not a genealogist. Many of her suggested apps could be applied to many different hobbies and interests. That was so nice. I'm thrilled at the response to the new book, Turn Your iPad into a Genealogy Powerhouse. And I'm really, really excited that it's helping. And you know, just recently, of course, what, November 2nd, Apple came out with a new iPad mini. That mini iPad is kind of competing with the Nook and some of the smaller ebook readers. But, you know, a little more quiet was the release of the fourth generation of the full-size iPad. That's the one I kind of have my eyes on. And in fact, if you've been wondering about that, and I know the holidays are coming, and I know people are making, you know, wish lists and Christmas lists and thinking about whether they're going to perhaps make the upgrade to the new iPad. I guess you call it the iPad 4. I have a blog post for you on my blog. I did some research because I was trying to decide for myself whether I wanted to make the upgrade. And anyway, I've got some questions for you on the blog that will help you as you answer these questions, they'll help you determine whether that upgrade is a good thing for you at this point in the use of your iPad for genealogy. So I'll have a link for you in the show notes to that blog post if those questions will help you out in making that decision. I don't know about the mini. I feel like, you know, I can barely see my regular iPad as it is without big old magnifying glasses on. So I don't know if the mini is in my future, but it's kind of nice that there are some options and sizes. Okay, well, and it's always nice to hear from all of you. Thank you all for writing in. And coming up right after this, I've got that gem, my interview with Denise Levenick, the family curator. It's here, the new version 5 of the award-winning Roots Magic Genealogy software. It makes researching, organizing, and sharing your family history easier and more enjoyable than ever. If you're looking to take the next step in your family history research and start recording your family tree in your own genealogy database, or if you've really been wanting to make a switch to a much more user-friendly program, then do what I did. I chose Roots Magic, and I'm really glad that I did. Throughout its 10-year history, Roots Magic has helped people research and share their family trees with innovative features like moving people from one file to another with your mouse, a source wizard to help you document your work, creating a shareable CD to give to family and friends, and running Roots Magic off of a USB flash drive when you're away from home. Roots Magic also received the award for easiest to sync from FamilySearch for their work in interfacing with that system. Really, what are you waiting for? Download your risk-free trial of Roots Magic 5 at rootsmagic.com. See why professionals and beginners alike choose Roots Magic at rootsmagic.com. Archiving, organizing, and digitizing family treasures is one of the greatest challenges for genealogists. In her book, How to Archive Family Keepsakes, Denise Levenick presents a game plan that breaks down the steps and provides a clear picture of the end goal. The worksheets and the checklists provide the kind of practical advice I know that I look for in how-to books. So there's no fluff, just common sense and usable information that's going to lead to organization success for you. Denise May Levenick is a writer, researcher, and speaker with a passion for preserving and sharing family treasures of all kinds. She's the author of How to Archive Family Keepsakes and the creator of the Family Curator blog, which you can find at thefamilycurator.com. It was voted one of the 40 best genealogy blogs in 2010 and 2011. Here's my conversation with Denise Levenick. Hi, Denise. Welcome to Genealogy Gems Podcast.
Hi, Lisa. Nice to talk with you today.
It seems like we just spoke. We just did our Family Tree Magazine podcast segment. It was the November episode. So everybody, I encourage you to check out that interview because, Denise, what you did for us was you really just brought clarity to the whole concept of digitizing photographs.
Oh, I'm so glad you found it helpful. Good.
Yeah. Well, and all of you listening, go check that out. I'll have a link in the show notes to get you over to that episode because we talk about the types of files, the size of the files, the whole nine yards. So that's really good. But Denise, all this information comes from your new book, and it's How to Archive Family Keepsakes, Learn How to Preserve Family Photos, Memorabilia, and Genealogy Records. And wow, you bit off a lot, but I'm so glad you did because this is really a comprehensive and yet step-by-step kind of book. Were you a little intimidated biting off that type of a project?
Well, it was a huge project. It started out a little bit smaller, but it just kept growing, you know?
Yeah. Well, what I love about this book is that it's much along the genre that I like to write, which is step-by-step, get me to how to do it, you know, and you give some great background, but you really get into the nuts and bolts, and there's lots of wonderful worksheets and guidelines to use. When we pick up this book, are we really going to be able to use it in regards to, is it just one ancestor's collection from their life? Or can we apply this book if we have what I have here in my home office, which is a closet full of, you know, multiple families, multiple generations worth of materials that we want to organize and archive?
Well, that's a great question. And I hope that people who have any amount of family keepsakes can use the book. Even people who don't have an inherited collection, maybe they are just thinking about the future of their own estate and the things that they have acquired in their own lifetime. But for a lot of us who've inherited lots of things and lots of different from lots of different families, like you have, it can become a real project, how to deal with all this. And I hope that my book will help you bring some sanity to the project of organizing your family keepsakes.
Well, that's a great point. So we can not only use it for an individual collection we inherit, we can use it for the whole kit and caboodle we've been hanging on to and saving that we've inherited along the way. But also, as you said, it's that preparation of our own archive. It's funny to think of our own stuff as an archive, isn't it? But truly that's what you're talking about. And of course, if it's well organized, if we go through the process of your book, wow, it's going to really look like something important and worth saving to the future generations.
It is. And one thing working with my ancestors, my family's archives has taught me is that, you know, we don't get to take it with us. And I begin looking at my own possessions in light of who will keep this, who will want it. And a lot of people are downsizing. So I think there's some practical ideas here for people at any stage in life and at any stage of taking care of collections of things.
Right. Let's go to the beginning, because I know that there's a lot of people listening out there. They may have boxes of items stashed away, and they're having a hard time visualizing what is the end result supposed to look like. And of course, if we can visualize that end result, it's going to be a lot easier to know if we're on track and to get there. And I know, you know, one of the catalysts for your book was the inheritance of your grandmother's collection. And you already had many other family history items of your own. How would you describe, what does the final organized result look like? What are we shooting for when we work our way to the end of the book?
You want to know, if we took a picture, what would it look like?
Yeah. You know, are we talking that we have now published our final book, or do we have organized boxes and, you know, that we can find what we're looking for?
Well, there's probably a little bit of both, and some might depend on what you want to do with everything. I was very happy and pleased when I was able to open a cupboard and look inside and see all of these nicely, they're just stashed in there. Archival, gray archival boxes, labeled, letters, photos. I have different decades of letters, and it just makes me feel good to see them all organized and protected And that's my grandmother's things, and I have them in a cabinet in my living room. Now, my aunt, who passed away last year, I have her things, but it's not quite so organized. Yet I feel pretty good that at least I've got everything in archival banker's boxes. And mostly they say something like box one, box two.
So it might be at various stages of organization process, obviously. I think what really got my engine going as I was looking at, you know, reading through the book was that I could end up with a collection that is not only safely preserved in boxes and the appropriate types of materials, but that when I am ready to do a family calendar, when I want to write a particular little book for my grandson, whatever the project is, I could go to my inventory sheets that you talk about and you give us, you know, actual copies we can use in the book. I can go to my inventory sheets and I can put my hands on the particular items I want, even if they are dispersed amongst different boxes, because I have an actual inventory. To me, that's exciting.
It opens up a lot of possibilities, doesn't it?
It does, because it means we don't have to be afraid of maybe doing an actual project, maybe a little gift we want to put together at Christmas time, because we know it's not going to mean 16 hours of, you know, plowing through the same boxes again because we don't know where things are.
Right, right. And it's hard on your things, too, all that handling over and over looking for things. It's really a lot easier on your pictures and your documents if you don't have to touch them as often.
Exactly, exactly. Okay, so what are the three types of family archivists? Because different folks, again, have a different end picture in mind. And you talk about that there's kind of three distinct categories we might find ourselves falling into.
Well, there really are. And this became especially true in my own family because my sister and I have been dealing with the estates of our family members. And my sister just puts her hands up and says, "Nope, I don't keep stuff. You take it. You're the keeper. You are the keeper of the stuff." And, you know, I got to thinking about it. She is really like a lot of people. She doesn't want a lot of clutter. She's a real minimalist, yet she knows the things are valuable. She will, if she had to, she would be taking care of things until someone else would come along and say, "Okay, I'll take that responsibility." Mm-hmm. She's a caretaker. She is a good steward of the family keepsakes. On the other hand, I am kind of a curator. I like collecting things. I want to take care of them. I want to share them. And I think a lot of us fall into that category. We're curators. And then there are people who are creators. And I think those people look at family keepsakes as material for a project they want to do. So if they're an artist, they might really zone in on the ephemera and the artistic things that you might find in a family collection. If they are writers, they might say, "Oh, the stories are wonderful. I want to get the stories out of here." And scrapbookers will find things. Genealogists, of course, will find lots of things. But there are also those kinds of genealogists who really are kind of data miners. They want names and dates. So I do think there are three kinds of people that have to deal with family collections: curators, caretakers, and creators.
I think that's a great way to put it. And I imagine we could have multiple hats too, couldn't we?
We could. Yeah. We can cross over.
Exactly. All right. Well, there's so much here in this book. I am just going to jump around because I want to dig into some of the really cool things and just give people a taste of what they're going to learn in this. Chapter 4 jumps out at me. It's Organize Your Archive. And I just have to ask you the question, how in the world do you decide what to keep and what to save? If you can answer that, it's the million-dollar question.
Oh, it's hard, isn't it? It's hard.
It is.
You know, my sister says, "You don't want this. What do you want?" I go, "Oh my gosh, look, it's a candy box, and it's full of every greeting card that Uncle Benny sent to my aunt. Isn't right. that sweet?" I mean, we don't really need to keep it, but I allow myself a box of ephemera, and I just put that aside. And you know, maybe one day I won't want to keep it. And there's not a great deal of genealogical value in it. But it's okay. You can mm-hmm. keep that. Now, of course, you want to keep anything, all the vitals, the vital information, you know, death certificates, birth records, obituaries. It's hard to decide. That's why I made a list in the book. And I try to point out the things where you might need to skim for information. And then you can decide whether you want to donate the item or throw it away, what you want to do with it.
Right. I actually appreciate that list because while it's not hard and fast, you're not saying we have to do it that way. I liked the fact that you were daring enough to put some things in a list that says, look, I give you permission. If you want to just skim these items, I would put these in the category of it's okay to toss them when you're done. And, you know, some of us, people who haven't inherited very much have a hard time even imagining being in that position. But my husband and I just went up and dispersed his mother's home. She has now retired and gone into a retirement home and is very happy there. It has a beautiful place. But there was just this big house left full of stuff, which is great, except for I've already done both my grandmother's. And, you know, all of her, it's starting to add up.
Right.
And
it's a lot of stuff.
It is a lot of stuff. And it can kind of take over your home. And as thrilled as I am, I find myself getting a little choosier. And I guess that's an advantage for the genealogist is that we have the experience to already know what's really valuable information and to kind of trust our gut. It's not too often I have ever had a major regret for having let go of something, when I just had to make a choice. You know, there's only so much shelf space, right?
There is. And thank goodness for digital photography because we can take pictures of things and keep that. You know, that's a big help.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think you make a really good point, you know, that we have sort of a wealth of riches. It sounds like you're in a situation like me. And a lot of people can't even imagine. You're so lucky you have all this inherited stuff. But if you had asked me 15 years ago, I would never have imagined I'd be here today with this. So you never quite know what the future holds in your family.
Exactly. And also, you know, that idea of looking back at some of the things we acquired 20 years ago and thinking, you know, that never ever did surface as being something that I really needed to go back to. I've recorded in my database. I still don't have any projects for it. Maybe I could let that go to make room for some more valuable things.
There you go.
Yeah. Kind of. It's almost like an ongoing sorting and resorting process.
It is. It is.
Now, when you were talking to some of the archivists out there and people in museums, they kind of have a little code they go by, which is storing like with like. You talk about that in the book. What does that mean? And do you abide by that rule?
I really do. I think what they mean is when you start to work with your archives, you'll find that you have different kinds of things, but they might all be thrown together in one big box, or maybe they lived in a drawer together. And you'll have paper documents, photographs, then you might have some, medals or little memorabilia pins or something. So all this stuff gets jumbled together. But when you want to preserve it or work with it, we find meaning in the context of things. And it's helpful to put the photographs together, all the black and whites together, all the colors photographs together, the slides, put the documents all together, keep the letters together. Now, that doesn't mean that you need to destroy the original order because that will help you understand things that are grouped. Like maybe you have a shoebox and there's a bunch of different stuff in that shoebox. But when you examine it closely, you see, oh, this is all from a wedding. This was all stuff about the wedding. That helps you understand what's in the box. But when you go to preserve it, the photographs need a different kind of care than the letters. And the letters need a different care than the corsage that got thrown in there. So it's best when you go to preserve things, if you can separate and keep like with like, and then store them appropriately for that kind of item.
Would you in some way record what the original context was as you're separating them out? Because I really can appreciate the like with like, but it's so hard to give up the context.
Well, that's where your digital camera comes in. So useful. Ah. I spread things out on the table and take a picture. I do that so often And then I put the things, some of the stuff I don't end up keeping, because it's really the fact of, oh, there was a collection of a whole box of stuff. I didn't know what it was. But when I looked at it, I saw, oh, this is my aunt's school teaching memorabilia. There were obviously gifts from children. So mm-hmm. I took some pictures, but I didn't need to keep all those little things, you know.
Right.
I let
right.
those go.
No, but I think that's a perfect idea, which is that overview picture. You could even just put that in with other items that are being stored, put it in a little envelope, and it's like a big picture overview of where these items came from.
Perfect. Exactly. You're making a scrapbook of that box. You know, you're recording what was together. And then you can, if there's newspaper clippings, you can store those separately from the documents, because we all know what happens when news clippings get next to paper or photos. That's pretty dangerous.
Yeah, absolutely. And in the book, you have the, like I said, the inventory sheets, the worksheets, kind of that step by step to literally, folks. I mean, she goes through it step by step. It's like having Denise sit next to you and hold your hand and give you the comfort to know it's okay. Because, you know, our fear is we're going to get into something and go, oh my gosh, I just painted myself into a corner. But what I love is not only do you have a process there, but we can have the assurance that there's an end goal that really does make sense, that you've thought this through and you've researched it. You've done it for us, which is fabulous. Fabulous. Let's switch gears completely again, because there's so much to touch on. But I know that one of the questions I have recently received from a listener was about all of these online digital storage companies. And it seems like they're all buying each other up. They all say they're permanent, but, you know, who knows what permanent really means online. In chapter 5, it's checkpoint number 10, you talk about signing up with an online legacy service. As I said, a lot of these services are talking about permanent storage. And, you know, we are digitizing our materials, so it kind of makes sense to have that backup. But nothing, of course, is really permanent when it comes to high-tech companies. And this is a huge investment of time if we do upload all of our information. So how does online storage, in your opinion, fit into the total archival plan?
Wow, that is a great question and a big one. you know, there are so many people that want to go completely digital these days. You get kind of scared. Here we are with Hurricane Sandy, the mm-hmm. huge storm, and people who were affected by different disasters. And in some cases, the only things that survived were things that were stored online. And then so much of our life is online, too. I mean, if you participate, if you have a blog, you have a lot of your writing and your photographs are online. You might have Facebook as kind of like a mini blog for a lot of people.
Right.
You might have pictures on Flickr or Picasa. I can only tell you what I do. I am a collector, so I like to keep my digital files in my own. I like to have a copy myself. I think it's wise to have a copy online. I use Dropbox services, but I back up everything onto multiple external hard drives. In the past few years, external hard drives have become so inexpensive. And if you have a Mac, you can use something like Time Machine, which automatically backs up your files. PCs have great programs too. I've used Carbon Copy Cloner and different ones. So I back up all my files to an external hard drive, and I back up that to another hard drive. Mm-hmm. And then I have copies on Dropbox. So lots of copies keeps stuff safe, locks.
Exactly. I think that's sound advice, because I think if we get in the idea that there's this one location and then it's safe, I don't think that really flies. For me, I have Carbonite on my computer, mm-hmm. and it backs up my entire computer, which there's a bonus, not only if something happens to your computer, but also if I buy a new computer, which I did, it was like one or two clicks, and everything that was on the original computer got downloaded by Carbonite onto the new one, and it was ready to go, but it also had the backup on their servers. It may not necessarily be a genealogy site, if you will, it could be a site like Carbonite or Dropbox or one of these other providers that do it on a more global scale, and then maybe have some fun with some of the genealogy photo sharing type sites and that kind of thing.
Right.
In a secondary kind of way, don't you think?
I think so. And the online sharing sites are really wonderful for, I kind of look at them like a project, you know, like doing a scrapbook or a photo book. It's your online photo sharing project. I would like to make sure that you keep your files in multiple places so that you ensure you have them.
Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, just even that secondary hard drive, something that you could toss. I have a little watertight fire safe, and I throw the little secondary hard drive and I have it on my calendar like once a quarter. I just go and, you know, add to it and put it back in there. And I know that I've got that as well. And so it's right at my fingertips. Okay. So we've kind of demystified that a little bit. And of course, given us permission to have these backups, these digital types of preservations going on in a couple different places. In chapter 9, you address digitizing paper, and you answer the question that so many people ask. After you digitize a document, what do you do with it?
You keep it.
You keep it. We love paper, do we not?
We love paper.
I know. So keep it if you can. I imagine that there might be some things, like you were talking about your aunt's teaching career. There might be some documents that you might scan and not necessarily keep them all.
Right, right. And if you're digitizing your own genealogy papers, you know, sometimes you don't need the original notes from a seminar you attended. You can scan that and keep the digital version.
Oh, good. See, everybody, you've got permission to do that now. We just got some more shelf space. Fantastic.
There you go.
And of course, I can't even let you go without talking about, you say in this book, how to break the paper habit in 7 steps. Let's talk about it. Are there really 7 steps to help give us the confidence to break a paper habit so that not every single piece of paper needs to stay piled up on our desk?
Well, it's a good place to start. It's 7 steps that will get you further than you are if you haven't really tackled going paperless. I think it is going paperless.
Ah, you know,
use less paper. I think one of the first things you can do, step number 1, is to pick a start date. I understand a lot of businesses do this. You pick a date like the anniversary of your business or January 1st, and you go digital from that date forward. That way, if you say, oh, I want to find something that happened 2 years ago, you know that that probably hasn't been digitized.
Oh, so perfect.
You go to your file first to find that. But if it's something that happened, you know, in February after you've gone digital, then you know, oh, that will probably be a digital file. Easier.
Great.
So pick a start date for 1. Step 2, I would say, print less. When you have a choice, don't print it. Save it to a PDF. Save it as a digital file. I think in the early days of the internet, we hit print, but now we should hit save.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know a lot of the Genealogy Gems premium members who are listening, we have covered in depth the whole different ways to use PDFs, how to manipulate them and save them and make them into text. And they're just so much more flexible than they used to be. And what a great way to go, because like you say, it reduces the paper level. So
right.
Wonderful.
And they're a very good archival format too. They're going to be around for a while.
And you save ink. Oh my gosh, the cost of ink.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, which is expensive. And then for step 3, I would say use a consistent file naming scheme, something you can find. I have a little cheat sheet I posted above my desk of my file naming scheme, and I have a couple of different ones, but they are consistent, and I use the different ones for a different purpose.
Now, you spell these out too in the book. I mean, you give some really good concrete examples so that they can develop their own, but feel pretty confident that it's within line of kind of what you were recommending that you've been using, and it's still working for you, right?
It still works.
Yeah.
You know, it might be a name date system I use for some things, and I use a numeric file ID for a lot of archival items. It's just faster and it's very efficient. So I talk about the pros and cons of each of those different systems and how to use those.
Right. Perfect. We love that.
Then step number four is, you know, from my days as a Cub Scout leader, that old KISS, keep it super simple. Keep your system easy and intuitive. Some people dream up these elaborate file naming schemes or digitization schemes, and too hard to remember. Just keep it simple.
Couldn't agree more. Perfect.
Number five is a workflow cheat sheet, as I mentioned, something you can post to just remind you, oh, well, I do digital with this, and this is my file naming scheme. And then when you come back to your research, you can pick it up easy. And number six, I would say, celebrate your digital birthday. That date you picked on number step number one, every year on your digital birthday, review your system, see if it's working, and you might need to upgrade or migrate your digital files to a new format. You know, we used to use floppies, and then we had to go to CDs and DVDs, and now we're using external drives. So pay attention to where you're storing your files.
But I love that, because that way it will always pop up at least once a year and jog us to think about reviewing that. When in the past, we always have good intentions, but there's nothing on the calendar poking us to say, come on, go check.
Right. Your digital birthday. And then number seven, of course, is purge the paper. So once you start going digital, you can work backward to get rid of paper. Like, as I said, scan old seminar notes, syllabi that you might want to keep, and apply your file naming scheme to those digital files so that they can be incorporated in your system. That's seven steps to get you started anyway.
Absolutely. And one of the ones that I learned many, many years ago, gosh, when the computers were just coming out and I was working at a corporation, was my office manager said, touch it once.
Good, yeah.
And it really forced me to make decisions and take action that moment with that item. Versus that, pick it up, go, I don't know what I'm going to do with this. And you set it down and you end up with all these stacks. It kind of brings me back to your book in that she would say, if you have a proper system that you know works, that you can rely on, that you can remember, you should always have a place to put it. There's no reason to set it down and touch it again later. And I think that's really what this book does for us, is it gives us that confidence to know that it's been thought through. There's places for things, it's understandable, it's easy to follow, and there is no reason to touch things so many more times. Like, as you said, it's not even that good for our stuff, but two, it's a time waster, and it kind of gives us permission to procrastinate, and that keeps us from research, doesn't it?
It does.
So
yeah.
This is absolutely ideal. Now, I'll indulge myself one more thing. Organizing paper files. So here's the big question, Denise. Do you think that a perfect system really exists? Yes or no? And we want to know, what's the system do you use? Are you truly using what you talk about in the book? And I know that you do reference that there are a couple different ways to go. What does Denise Levenick do?
Oh my gosh, you're going to come peek inside my office, huh? Is there a perfect system? If there is, please tell me what it is.
Right.
No, there's no perfect system. We're always going to be looking for it, but perfectionism is the enemy of productivity.
Yes. Yes, so true.
What do I use? You caught me out. I've used binders, three-hole binders. Mm-hmm. I've used file folders in my cabinet. I go back and forth. Some files are in one place for one thing and some are in another. I'm kind of a binder person because I tend to misplace papers if I have them loose. So notebooks really work best for me for my source information. But because I'm always in a hurry, my reference things I tend to put in file folders in a file cabinet.
I am primarily probably 90% a three-ring binder person. I've been threatening to share more information about that on with my premium members, because there is a system, and it kind of mirrors my hard drive system, which is not too, it's real similar, kind of in line with what you talk about in the book. But Don't you think that the key is really that you just have to commit to whatever the system is that you're going to do? And as you said, be consistent.
Yeah, you just have to take it with its faults and make the best of it, make it work for you. And then you can keep moving forward with your research, and you're not filing papers and refiling and inventing new systems. And you just need to move forward.
Yeah, absolutely. I really appreciate you taking the time to really sit down. And we didn't just do a gloss review. You've given us some really good, usable techniques and ideas right out of the gate in just this half an hour so that people can really start getting organized. And I have to say, I mean, I talk about books here on the podcast, but I'm pretty few and far between. I mean, I'm choosy because it really matters to me that I'm familiar with the work and that it works for me. And I have to say, I was just really impressed with how comprehensive the book was and yet how easy to follow. And you really filled in all the blanks. If nothing else, I think people are going to come away with such a confidence to be able to take this on. And I teach a class all the time about how to save your research from destruction. And I think that it's absolutely critical that our materials today look respectable. You know, that it's not just all tossed in a box, but that they're well cared for, they're archival safe. Nobody's going to walk into your home office and go, oh, well, she tossed this in the box, I guess I can toss the box. But when it's really put together in such an organized way as you've walked us through with the book, it's going to be respected and it's going to be handed down for generations. I just think that is such a gift.
Well, thank you, Lisa. It's an honor to be able to care for our ancestors' things and the things that they treasured. It really is an honor. And mm-hmm. you have to respect that what they were trying to do sometimes. And I appreciate very much what you said. Thanks.
Yes, absolutely. Well, and I know that when you and I first met a couple of years ago, I think it was at like Southern California Genealogy Jamboree.
It was.
You were very, very close to your mother. And then shortly thereafter, you know, she passed away. I'm fortunate enough that that hasn't happened yet, but we all face those times. And I imagine that this was really, I don't know what's the word, cathartic. It's very empowering to know that you could give a gift of a legacy to your mother and to your grandmother by doing this. And here you are, helping everybody else do the same.
My mom, she sits with me sometimes, I think. I have her picture on my desk. You were one of her favorite people. Oh. And I think that's why she liked Jamboree so much, because she would say, I have to go to all of Lisa Louise's talks. You know, my mom was not a real professional genealogist at all, mm-hmm. but she reminds me that a lot of us are caretakers of our ancestors' lives and their memories. And that's what we try to do is save things for the next generation, however they approach it.
Well, she was such a sweet and dear woman. And you are too, Denise May Levenick. Thank you so much. Denise is the family curator. And let me tell you again, her book is How to Archive Family Keepsakes, Learn How to Preserve Family Photos, Memorabilia, and Genealogy Records. What could be more important? Thanks, Denise.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Well, you know me, I've always got my eye out for a great book, and I really think that this one's a keeper. Again, it's called How to Archive Family Keepsakes by Denise Levenick. You're going to love it. I have my copy. I've already been marking it up and starting to use it. As I said, on all the reorganizing I've been doing in the last couple of weeks, you can get your copy at my website. Head on over to genealogygems.com, head to episode number 144, and there you will find a link that will take you over to Shop Family Tree. Of course, I always appreciate when you use our links because the show gets credit for sending you over there. And that means that you're financially supporting the podcast at no additional cost to you. In fact, I've got a special coupon code for you that will save you 10% off the book and really your entire purchase over at Shop Family Tree. Click the link and type in the coupon code GENEALOGYGEMS. That's good through December 31st of 2012. 10% off the entire order, and you're going to have a book that is truly going to help you once and for all. get organized, get your photos digitized, and archive all those wonderful family keepsakes. Well, that brings us to the end of Genealogy Gems podcast episode number 144. Now, before I leave you today, I want to share one more email with you from the mailbox. This one comes from Tina in the UK, and she writes, "Your recent blog post about items found when clearing out a house reminded me of my most significant find in my stepfather's attic. He died in July 2009, and my mom wanted to clear out and sell their big house and move to a retirement flat to be near the family in Bristol. I should explain that my mother and father divorced when I was a baby, and my stepfather was like a father to me. We threw out masses of stuff. He never did. Ever. But this was mostly correspondence, company reports for all his shares, etc., which we sifted through without much of note being found. Then in the attic, there were two extraordinary finds. Number one, a box full of the small notebooks he kept from his school days till a few years before he died. The early ones, and especially the ones of his years in the army in India and Burma, were full of dates, places, and distances traveled, including addresses he stayed at in the UK when on leave, which I was later able to identify as the homes of various relatives, because there was also a wartime address book in the collection. The later notebooks are a record of his expenses, with dates, items, and expenses which brought back many memories. That is, a doll for Tina, bought in New York on holiday in 1958. I remember it well. It was sort of a pre-Barbie. Every ice cream he ever bought us, there was a lot of ice cream. He loved it. There's so much I haven't yet had time to go through them in detail, and I'm not sure what to do with it all. Number two, my grandfather's, my mother's father, old attaché case, full of letters from my stepfather's mother between 1978 and her death in 1993. There were hundreds of them, and yes, I read every single one, and they have formed the basis of the story of her life. Yes, she also left a small diary, a collection of her own recipes of family favorites, and a very simple family tree, which I am now writing. The letters were mostly about her daily life. She decided to stay in Brazil in a retirement home there when my stepfather retired to England, with very little about family history. But what very little there was seemed to be an answer to some of his questions. He tried to find out some things in the days before the internet, but gave up when he found it too difficult. I only recently started doing family history in 2006. But these little gems of information from his mother, in quotation marks, "my mother came from Longford in Ireland." Yes, she did. In quotation marks, "your father went to Banff as a child in Scotland to visit his grandmother's family." In quotation marks, "my father came from Hereford, I think." Yes, he did. Were invaluable to me. With all that was available in 2009 and since online, I was able to put together an extraordinary family tree with all the side branches of his relations too. With help from his distant cousins, I discovered along the way also into family history. And the search goes on. His mother was right about all except one fact, that her father fought in the Boer War. No, he didn't. Which is not bad going for someone born in 1897. He would have been fascinated. It just shows that the smallest things can provide clues. Well, thank you so much, Tina, for writing and for sharing this. It certainly does remind us that clues can come from anywhere. But it also reminds us of something else. That while it's wonderful to have our history recorded so it can be remembered, sometimes it's the smallest things that are remembered the most, like ice cream. I think I'm going to sign off now and take my grandson Davy out for a cone. I hope he remembers it, because I know I will. Who will you invite out for an ice cream cone and spend your precious time with today? Thanks for listening, friend. I'll talk to you soon.
Branches in the wind, still standing here together. One more storm to weather, we'll get through it yet. So we're gathered here, holding on to each other. let go of another one we won't forget. Now as we say goodbye to one of our own, we may be lonely, but we're not alone. Though the leaves will fall and the tears will flow, may it always comfort us to know the family tree will always grow.